It is said that the private sector is the engine of growth. They play a very significant role in the country. But are they being given the right level of support to remain competitive? What is the state of private businesses in the country right now? Are they being given the right support? Do we need another stimulus package to aid the growth of these firms? You remember this line when they said the private sector is the engine of growth. But it's still the engine to support that growth and recovery. Well, on PM Express Business, they should look at Ghana's economic recovery and the private sector. We've heard from the Bank of Ghana, we've heard from government, we've heard from the Ghana Statistical Service about the fact that the economy is recovering. But what about those private businesses down there? Are they feeling this impact of this recovery? Well, there's no other person to engage on this and other myriad of issues happening in the private sector and development at the macro level and how it's impacting on them. And I'll say Bonsu is the chief executive of the Private Enterprise Federation, and I'll be engaging him on this. We heard about the National Development Bank. We heard about the new trade deal. What about AFTA? It has taken off. But is Ghana really and is going to benefit from this? Well, maybe I might be riding ahead of myself, but I'll wait to get the comments of the chief executive of the Private Enterprise Federation, and also Bonsu. And also, you can send your comment if you are a private business out there and you're not feeling the heat. This is PM Express Business Edition. They command a larger chunk of this economy, and therefore whatever that happens to them is believed to be critical and they need the required attention. I'm talking about those private businesses out there and how are things faring for them. In these times when there is talk about recovery, we still see a lot of people who are saying that they've not been called back yet at home and they don't know what is happening. We still hear from private businesses who argue that they are struggling to secure the required credit from the commercial banks. So is it that there's a mismatch between what is happening at the macro level, and what is happening down there? Or maybe I am talking too much. Let me bring in Nanaose Wonsu. He is the chief executive of the Private Enterprise Federation to get some understanding as in what is happening on the ground and also get his thoughts on a lot of things that are happening at the national level that have significant impact on private businesses. Nana, how are you doing?
I'm well. I'm getting better every day.
It's great that the last time we were talking about the state of the sector, now we're looking at how certain critical things are impacting on them. But again, it'd be good to, before we spoke the other time, we were all waiting for the mid-year review. Now it has been done. We are just 3 months to the end of the year. Mm-hmm. Can I also still find out from you, as we speak right now, what is the state of private firms in the country as we speak right now? How are they doing?
Recovering. See, when you're sick, you're getting better every day, but it doesn't mean you've gotten over the hump. Mm. And now you are in a straight arena. We are recovering. We're still struggling. Because as you said correctly in your opening, a lot of businesses have not recovered fully, or almost 50% yet. Some of their employees are still home. Some of their patronage are still dwindling, and they still have the cost structure that their supply chain is still there. So we are struggling. We are on our way. Can we sustain this recovery? Can we get the impetus? Can we get the support that are necessary for us to sustain our recovery?
I find this comment, Nana, very interesting, because with 3 months to the end of the year, I was expecting to hear from you that, George, we've gotten back on our feet. Things have picked up, you know, and we are looking forward to an exciting end of year. Well, with 3 months, or if I'm right, August, September, October, November, December, I mean 4 months or something, your words doesn't give me any encouragement. Well, if George, this is what I should be hearing from the private sector.
George, you know, private sector reacts to conditions that they find themselves confident of. They act on where they have the feel that, yes, this is the situation, and this is what we're going to do. They invest on the certainty of the opportunity. Now, the pandemic has not subsided yet. We're still going through the recovery through the pandemic. We're still getting the second virus and all that. So businesses are still hesitant because the virus is still depleting the resources of businesses. And so businesses are now, if you look at the credit demand of business, it's gone down. Why is that? Because they don't know where to invest. They don't know how to invest. And when businesses are hesitant, they don't invest. And that's why I said we are recovering, but we're not there yet.
How has this uncertainty affected this your challenge of where to invest and not invest? Because I heard this old mantra or song from businesses about access to credit and being a bigger challenge.
Yes.
Now, some of the banks are saying that we have credit available, funds available. You're not coming for it.
But businesses are not demanding.
Why are you not doing that?
If you take it, if you take the credit, what are you going to do with it? When you're not certain whether you have the key staff who are going to work with you, whether you have the key personnel who are going to work with you, whether you have the patronage from businesses that rely on, and whether you have your supply chain certain to be delivered. Mm-hmm. So you may have access to credit. When you borrow, what are you going to do with it? And that is why I said we're recovering, but the certainty is not there.
But there are some staff who are still working and they are receiving half salary.
Oh, yes.
And so if you have a way to get money from the banks to pay, why don't you go for this loan and service these staff that are still working for you?
You have staff that you're paying. We maintain certain staff levels.
At half salary?
Half salary, or even some of them full salary. But now maintaining that is a cost. And you don't have the patronage to bring you the income stream to offset the cost. So why go borrow when you don't even know where to put the money, when you cannot deliver, when the patronage, the demand side is not there? So what we're saying is, yes, the recovery has started and some businesses are doing better than others, but we haven't recovered, I would say, 50% or more. No, we haven't. And that is where the problem is.
When will you see this getting back to these private business banks or getting back to these banks to make use of the capital that is available?
Well, you see, in our environment, we always depend on credit.
Yeah.
Now, businesses are getting wiser and better because if you are a startup, if you are a medium level growth business, credit is very expensive for you. The cost of money, number one, is expensive, high anyway by itself. Mm. But where do you put your debt management when your income stream is not that certain? And so you rely on debt to be able to project your business or to prepare your business. Then you have to pay back. You take $1 and you come with 1.5 that you have to pay. Where is the 0.5 coming from? From profits that you generate. And we're not sure that the profit is there. So don't go for the credit. Rely on your income stream, internally generated funding to allow you to be able to stay afloat. This way you don't burn yourself out.
But then some will say that then government comes in these recovery in these times as well. Some have talked about stimulus package. Some have talked about tax rebate and all the rest. Have we gotten it right in terms of government supporting private businesses to aid their recovery?
Government is making efforts. Are they enough? No. The efforts are not enough for businesses to do what they need to do. You see, when we talk about access to credit, access to finance and resources, we forget about our investment program in Ghana. We attract foreign businesses. And they come in with loaded with tax incentives. That is depletion of income stream to government for the future. Now, they take profit margins at the end of the period, repatriate them home. That is depletion of resources from within the country going out. What we lack as private indigenous businesses is access to long-term pool of funding, low-cost funding, which will allow us to be able to do what we need to do to become competitive. So when you look at government stimulus package, which is a result of the residual of what has happened, Then you said, oh, government gave 600 million. Is it enough? No way. If you're talking about our economy and the stand and the status of our indigenous businesses, they're not receiving the necessary tools, mm-hmm. infrastructure deficiency. Now we have the rains. Mm. Those people involved in grains and others go around Atebubu, Ejura, Asantemampo, and others. The grain owners, they don't have warehouses. So they have to sell at a discount to make some money out of the chaotic condition. Mm. These are shortcomings of the private sector. These are shortcomings of the businesses. Mm. And the people, the intermediaries who take these grains and then, you know, plow them into value addition products, they cannot afford to. And you have others who can't even get to any market at all. Mm. So when I say recovering, we're recovering at a slow pace, but we're not getting the necessary things that we need to do. The access to credit we're talking about, why should we always go on debt?
You think equity is the way out?
Equity is the way out.
But how many of the businesses out there has come to appreciate that equity is the way out?
When you don't know about something, you don't appreciate 100%
of nothing and then 1% of zero. A fortune or something.
Yes, you see, because they're not aware of that. We've always been pushing credit, the banking credit. There's no competitive alternative to credit. Mm. But if government were to assist, like we did on the Venture Capital Trust Fund, mm. what did it do? Take government endowment, mix it with private sector equity, and then create a pool of funding available to businesses to tap into that they don't have to pay. We share the profit if we make money. And they make money and they share the profit. Mm. So instead of getting a startup, a medium business, to go and borrow and pay at expensive cost, you give them incentive that will allow them to rely on private equity, on partnership arrangement, and make money and split. Mm. That is the way to go, because we have relied on credit for since God created Adam. Mm.
It's not helping.
It hasn't helped any. Isn't about time that we look at alternatives? Even about time that we look at incentivizing those businesses that can create that kind of resource pool, long-term pool of funding. Let me give you an example. I have this book here.
Yeah.
It's called Long-Term Savings. This is what we wrote some years back, 2004. And it's to accumulate pool of funding for investment in private sector. Mm. That was turned into the third year of our pension scheme.
Yeah.
And you have funds in the pension scheme that are available to be used by private sector. That angle was actually structured to assist private sector in accumulating resources. Mm. Are we doing that? NPRA has structures and levels of investment where you can put your money. Forgetting that the ultimate objective of the long-term savings, which was converted in its entirety into the third year, was to create a pool of long-term funding for private sector use. Is that where we have allowed? No, we haven't allowed that. So we have to look at how do we expect our businesses to survive or to become competitive when they don't have the resources? Mm. This is where we
are. Nana, how would you, I mean, we are still within the pandemic. The stars for other developed economies has been different. Mm-hmm. How would you rate government in terms of support for private businesses, aiding private businesses in these times, COVID? Could they have done better?
Oh, there's a lot we can do.
How would you rate government handling of the whole intense of private sector?
I don't want to do ratings because I'm not in the ratings business.
Do you think that they could have done better than what they've done right now?
There's always room for improvement.
Do you think they could have done better?
I've worked with government on the other side of the coin on a platform called the WAFSCON, West Africa Private Sector COVID-19 Platform, of which I'm the chairman.
Yeah.
And we work with government various levels, including the highest levels of government.
Yeah.
They're making efforts.
But could they have done better than what is happening right now?
When you have resources, but when your hands are tied, how better can you do?
So you think that within the limited resources, they've done better?
Oh, I think within the limited resources, they've done a lot.
But there are still a lot of businesses out there.
Oh, there's a lot of businesses.
There are some who are saying that we don't need cash out. We need even incentives. We need rebates.
George, let me now that you brought this up, let me bring this angle. We have lots of funds in the country, held up by government. We have Heritage Fund, we have Infrastructure Fund, we have various funds that can be deployed to assist private sector to influence their dynamic growth, that will catalyze the other side of the coin to bring those low-hanging fruits to become viable businesses. But sometimes the bureaucratic level has to, oh, this Heritage Fund should not be used. This Infrastructure Fund. Now we talk about Infrastructure Fund. I just mentioned about absence of, what do you call it, warehouses for these grains and all. You see how it's affecting our poultry farm and poultry in industry and all, and we're importing about 400 million poultry. How would you deplete your grains that will allow you to create a poultry feed? So these are, you know, cyclical things that we can use to catalyze some growth sectors within the economy, and that is not happening. But as I said, the government is doing something. Is it enough? No, it's not enough. Do they have the resources? I think sometimes we are misguided as to what resources we need at what time. Because if I'm going to create a pool of 600 million in Heritage Fund sitting idle in a bank account, how helpful am I to the private sector who could turn around, use that 600 million to create a catalytic effect on the other sectors to grow the economy?
Do I get from you that they could have done better in supporting private businesses?
Well, better in the sense that the legislation that we create to honor this or to administer these things sometimes are not the domain of the current government or the previous government, but is the domain of the legislature. How do we go back and ask them, look, we set this aside for rainy day. It hasn't rained, but the sun is so scorching, we can't afford to stand in there. So let's turn it into other uses. These are sometimes we boxed ourselves into a corner and we can't do much. So as much as I think the government itself might want to do something, they should be looking at the various infrastructure, various resources that are available within the country and use it to catalyze the growth of the economy.
Because someone said that 600 million Ghana cedis to support private businesses might not be enough.
And
I know that this is past events that have taken place. If you read the Auditor General's report and you look at you hear the wastage, then you ask yourself, how can we efficiently allocate resources to touch the right spots in the sectors of the economy to turn things around? And that's why I come back to my question about how government has managed private sector.
I'm not even looking at the I'm not even looking at the inefficiencies in the system. That's the wastage in the system. I'm looking at absence of deployment of viable resources that we have available to us, but the absence of maybe enlightened ways to use the resources that have prevented us from taking advantage of those. So I think they can do better if we need to revisit the various angles as to how, what do we have on the table. Let's look at the entire table. Let's look at the paucity of little things here and there. Look at the entire table. The investment plan. Do we want to continuously attract foreign investors who can repatriate the profits from without partially influence the growth of our subsectors, the growth of our indigenous businesses. Now we talk about continental free trade. How are we going to be competitive when we don't have the technical know-how, we don't have the resources, and we're just dwindling in our little corners?
Yeah, so, there are some private businesses who dread and are worried because we still have a third wave that we are still assessing its real impact. They say that, listen, George, if first and second, we couldn't see the light at the end of the tunnel in terms of government support and real assistance. That was just like how they did other governments have done for their firms and other economies. Some have already given up, Nana.
No, I don't think most of our businesses have given up, but most of our businesses are scared. Scared in the front.
They're giving up or they are worried or scared, right?
Scared.
Because they don't see that support coming from government.
How do I get my staff to confidently come in? Do I even know, do they know if they have contracted the COVID? Do they know that they're going to contract it through the throat or something? We keep testing. Some test positive, some test negative. The moment you have one positive in your environment, you scare the daylights off everybody. So businesses are scared. And once they're scared, as I said, the key man, George Yaffe, is my key staff. If he goes, there goes the company. Mm. And if George is not well, the company is not well. Mm. So we have to be able to encourage George to come in every time. But coming in every time, this kind of the new dynamism of doing business in remote control and virtual, is it working really for us? In our environment, not really, because sometimes you need supervision. The guy's staying at home. His kids are surrounding him. He needs to attend to some obvious, responsibility at the time. He couldn't. There goes the company. There goes the opportunity. There goes the income stream that should have accrued at the time. So there's a dawn of a new era, the new way of doing business, which we were not planning for, which we didn't plan for, which we didn't have the capacity. Mm-hmm. We're now easing ourselves gradually into that and easing our employees into that. Mm-hmm. So those are the kind of things that we got to do and do better. And that's where you need government. But you see, government itself doesn't have the resources as we look at. It's an engine of growth, private sector. We're only paying 13% of taxes.
I'll be coming back, back to
but that. But I want us to look at it in the sense that it's beneficial to businesses when the government tax stream is huge, so they can turn around and reinvest some in private sector. Because at the end of the day, it's private sector which contributed to that. So the benefit of taxes to government cannot be overstated. And the point of government's role in the development of private sector cannot even be discussed, because it's a fait accompli. Without the benefit of government, private sector is nowhere to go.
Interesting. So let me come back to this whole question about the fact that there's still a third wave that is hanging there that we are all worried about.
We're scared of that.
What should be the approach going forward for government and how they should handle the private sector? Because some are saying that, listen, first ask you, do you think that we need another stimulus package?
Oh, stimulus, we need, whether there's a third wave or not, we need
stimulus.
Do
we need a stimulus package?
We need
How
a
should
lot
it
of
be structured?
Do structured we in a private equity, not credit. Please, for God's sakes, we have suffered enough within the 62 years of what? Independence, and we're still relying on credit.
So we need another stimulus package.
We need long-term, let me craft the language.
So let me get the better understanding from you.
Long-term pool of funding at low cost.
But that's a long-term issue. I'm looking at now with respect to the fact that
I need it now for long-term.
So you need a long-term stimulus package.
We need a long-term.
That will not be structured on debt, but on equity.
On equity.
Interesting.
That is shareholding arrangement, where business and business partner, and we bring the technical expertise and competency and all to grow the business so we can share the profit. It happens in various jurisdictions. Why not ours? Why do we always have to look at debt? When you are a young entrepreneur going to the business and you started with debt, with asking for collateral, you have to go to your uncle to bring the asset or the family to back your business. And when the business collapses, the family collapses. We don't need those kind of things. We can do as others have done successfully in creating the pool of partnership resources that will allow businesses with the technical skills that come with it, because these partnerships come with technical things that normal average business wouldn't know. And then they grow the business to the greener heights, to levels that people don't anticipate. And they split the profit.
And it's not everyone who is interested in equity. Some people still want the debt. Some people are still arguing that I want even just maybe 20,000 or 50,000 from government to restructure my business that I've been hit by COVID. I will pay back.
You will pay back the 20,000. Is that enough for you?
50,000?
50,000 possibly might not be enough. But if you're looking at this myopic level, that the technical point is you want to own everything 100% by you, so you don't want a shareholding arrangement, you don't want to share with it. So your limitation is to to yourself and your technical skills that you don't have enough at length. You don't have the marketing strategy. You don't have the investment strategy. You just there when people come in to knock at your door, we want 5 CDs of bread, and that's what you give them. You don't want to go back and create a mill or be a partnership in a mill development that definitely can enhance your profit margins. Mm. So those are not business people. Those are fly by night. They want to make a little bit or hang in there. We're talking about legitimate business that want to grow.
Mm.
Every business has to have opportunity to grow.
Mm.
And if you have the opportunity and you say, oh, I don't want to grow, I want debt. And the debt is that I can pay back and go home. The reason a lot of people want debt is because they don't have access or they don't know how to manage partnership, because they think partnership brings trouble. They forget about the legal arrangement that can put in place a partnership.
Mm.
So the private equity angle is lost on us. And so every time the government itself is talking, it's talking about private sector credit. Bank of Ghana publishes the credit demand of private sector. It's gone down the last few months because we're not demanding. Have they published the equity use of private sector?
But now you also that you don't need the money now because you don't know where you're going to deploy it.
No. The fact that I don't need it now doesn't mean I cannot structure a partnership arrangement. I don't need now.
But for the banks, they want to give out debt. They want to give out credit.
The banks are
that
like
is the issue right the now, and you like, don't need the money.
No, the banks are like private sector business. They're private sector businesses.
Yeah, they are members of your association.
Yes, they are members of me.
And, are you engaging them to give you money?
No, we are engaging them, but they also have to pay back their patrons.
Shareholders.
Their shareholders.
Creditors.
Yes. So they are in the business as much as the green, developer. So they are in the same boat, because they also take the money at cost and sometimes at high cost. Can they afford that? If they don't take it, competition is going to eat them dry. So they have to burn the bridge and take that credit.
Mm.
But for the average person, why do I need to take it? And I gave an example, a startup, a growing business. They don't have a market share. They're now growing. And they take credit. Where's the income stream? Where's the patronage to give them the income stream to be able to pay the debt? That's why you have a non-performing loan portfolio in majority of the banks. Because the off-takers didn't have the resources to pay back.
Because I'll be coming back to get your thoughts on it. Because the accusation is that most of your members, your private businesses, are just not paying back this money. And it has an impact.
I just gave you the example.
I know, but
the patronage is not there. He anticipated that he was going to take the debt, turn it around, and make money and pay back. He couldn't make the money. But his first allegiance is to his business. So he's not going to drive the business to pay the debt. And that's why if you are giving them alternative to debt, the equity, he could take that money, re-channel, re-invest, and be able to pay back. Because it's not, you see, we look at the short-termish of our investment. But as I said, long-term pool of funding, 5, 7, 10 years. Good. Don't touch it. You reinvest. You have technical competence. You have the market strategy. You have the investment strategy. These things work.
Then it will be a good time for us to take a short break. This is PM Express Business Edition. As we put the private sector on the table and looking at the fact that the economy is recovering, but how are those private firms down there being impacted or actually getting back into their feet? We'll be right back after this break as I engage the Chief Executive of the Private Enterprise Federation, Nana Osei-Bonsu. Welcome back to PM Express Business Edition as I engage the Chief Executive of the Private Enterprise Federation, Nana Osei-Bonsu. As you do a reality check of the state of the private sector, their health, how are they recovering? And we see all the data suggesting that the economy is recovering. Are those private firms, are they really recovering? Or they are still struggling to get back on their feet? With the third wave of COVID-19 still scaring at them. Nana, thank you so much. And we went to the break and we are back again. And
thank you,
and
sir.
Interesting discussions while we were off. But as I was trying to find out from you, that in terms of the way forward, credit and all the rest, recently the Bank of Ghana released data that sort of give us an impression that these banks are lending that and lending that and all the rest. I mean, for you, what do you make of all these things in trying to bring some transparency when it comes to lending?
I want an argument with alternate source of financial resources available to private sector other than debt. That's the point. Because we have relied on debt, and a lot of businesses have collapsed because their businesses could not make enough income to pay off the debt. So now let's look at the other alternatives. Private equity, as I said, partnership with technical assistance that can boost the investment to the highest levels of returns. We don't use that. We don't talk about that. And you said earlier that some businesses say, I want it all mine, or I don't want to share, or I don't want to be a partner.
There are different routes in going to Rome.
And that's why they will go to the credit market. No problem with that.
Somebody will fly directly to Rome. Somebody wants to go to US and fly.
Thank you.
So there are different ways of dealing with a problem.
But there's a glaring absence of that alternative. Glaring absence of that alternative for private equity. And that is what I want us to create in our system. If this new development bank resources of whether 250 million or 500 million, if you give it to five private equity funds to bring counterpart money, they will yield an equivalent of 50%, 250 or 500. That is long-term. Long-term, and then they would go and invest in businesses and provide the technical assistance, the market study, and the market share, and all the things that businesses don't have to be able to make the business more viable and profitable.
You're talking about long-term funds, and it would be a good time for me to ask you, the National Development Bank, I knew you had your own concerns about it. I mean, all other things being equal, it should take off before the close of this year. What do you make of it?
Do we need a National Development?
You still think that we don't need it?
No, we don't. The way it's structured.
Look, how should it be structured before we think that we need a National Development Bank?
A development bank has its marching orders to invest in various sectors where normally business people would invest because of risk exposure in that and all. So development bank would give resources at, you know, or incentives for businesses to take the plunge. Now, this development bank, I don't know how they're going to function. They are supposed to resource the normal commercial banks. Why? This development bank is not a depository-taking institution. So where are they going to get additional resources? The 500 that we endow them with, that's what they're going to do?
By investing. They're investing. Every business
So why
invests.
Should they invest in even the financial institutions whose credit people are not taking, as you said correctly?
But that's just a short-term issue, Nana.
Well, then why should we go that route? Can't we have alternatives? Can't we partner with private equity institutions, as I said, for them to bring additional money? Look, let me give an example. And this is the book here. The Long-Term Savings and the Venture Capital. Government gave 22 million. The venture capital, we went out, partnered with private banks and others to create 60 million endowment. That is additional funding without government. And that was invested in private equity in different businesses to grow them up. So we have alternatives. It's been demonstrated.
You think that the structure is where the problem is?
The structure.
You think it's bound to fail?
No, the objective is where the problem is.
But there's a problem also with the structure of the development.
Because if you give the right objective, the structure will vary. But if the wrong objective, the structure will be the same. So how different are they to the money market banks who are also giving credit? Because they deplete their credit, they go to the development bank and take additional and come and give additional credit. So the private sector is boxed in between. It doesn't have alternatives. Let's give private sector alternative in creating long-term. And as I said, the third-tier pension scheme is supposed to accumulate lots of resources. I think they have some billions of cedis now. Let them invest in private equity. Let them invest in private sector. That's why they were set up for. This book confirms that. Act 680, November 4, 2004. That's when the act was put together. And that was converted into the third-tier pension scheme. Pension funds have pool of funding that should be allowed to be invested in private sector, not in government treasuries. They weren't set up for government treasuries. These were private business pension schemes, private individual pensions that were accumulating. So they should go back and refurbish private sector interests, not government interests.
Not being a prophet of doom, but now do you think that looking at the way this whole development bank thing is being structured, it is bound to fail?
No, I'm not going to be a prophet of doom and predict that they're bound to fail. But we don't have a culture. We haven't had a culture of successful development bank. NIB, where is it? It's not a full-fledged bank. It's still there, but as was
struck. The next one would be ADB. ADB
is still there. Now they have a new board who are struggling to redirect ADB to the original mandate so they can continue to do business. Mm. So we haven't had a successful National Development Bank. So when the Bretton Woods institution come to us and say, oh, you need a development bank, you should tell them, go away. Give us the money to reinvest in something else, non-development bank.
It's interesting that a lot of people are quite excited about it. You're not excited.
Oh, no. Because from day one, we've been talking to them when the World Bank came, when the Africa Development Bank came, and all. We're telling them the deficiency in development banking system. Mm. We don't have something, and I keep coming back. The equity angle is missing in our environment. Go to some of these institutions, mature economies. What pushed them to that level? Mm. The equity with the technical expertise to drive the industries. Why are we now, banks don't give technical assistance. They give loans and, you know, buyer beware. You either come pay or we do something. That's not what businesses are looking for, because businesses are also desperate in need of technical assistance, the expertise to drive their industry. Businesses, because you are in that business, so you know everything A to Z about the business. No, you need some help with expertise coming from third parties.
Private sector, the engine of growth. Do you think that we are living this mantra of this administration because they believe in it? Or listen, it's gone somewhere. It's no longer the engine.
Oh, it is.
It's a dead lorry somewhere, struggling to get ties to even move.
Yeah, okay. It's an engine, but the state of the engine is what we're talking about.
It's blocked, it's down.
The engine possibly...
It needs to go to Abosoka to be repaired.
Needs some oiling, needs some refurbishing, needs some retooling. Mm. Yes, but it is the avenue to create wealth. Because we look at it as private sector to create jobs. Mm. Are you kidding me? Nobody sets up a business to create jobs.
Why?
They set up a business to make
profit.
Money.
But in that way,
and
you,
when
you,
they
you
money,
create jobs as well.
When you're making money, then you expand and you create jobs.
You forget
so job
your CSR function of making money as well.
CSR.
Corporate social responsibility. You create jobs as well.
No, sir. No, sir. You don't legislate CSR. My CSR is to give to my nephews.
Interesting.
Your CSR is to give to...
What about the environment you're operating and benefiting from?
Then there's no taxes. That's what the taxes are for. That's what the taxes are for. Businesses are not going to pay their taxes and pay for the community. They are to make money. That's why they set
up. Isn't it a dent on your conscience as a business?
Oh, sir. You see, a dent as a conscience. When he started a business, whose money did they start with?
The money, shareholders, funds, creditors as well.
No.
From
community. No. The guy started from his kitchen and he's growing his business to the level he may yield and create jobs on the part of that. The company has now moved from the kitchen to the living room, to the street and all. There is responsibility, but there's no obligation. You cannot legislate CSR. Mm. CSR is, if I want to, if I feel the community that I work in is not functioning well, I want to create my partnership with them and do as they would want to do to them. Mm. But don't let's make it an obligation, because the tax obligation is what the businesses pay and government has to take it and do the CSR that government has to do. But businesses on their own also contribute to the welfare of the community. Mm. But that is CSR, corporate social responsibility. It varies from everybody. You, me, and everybody else. But when you say that, oh, because you take money and people come to purchase your or patronize my business, and that is, I take the money, I pay my taxes, the responsibility, and then I take the profit home. That profit can be utilized for different ways. But let's not make CSR as if it's mandatory. Mm. So you got to do. No. Mm. It came some time ago, some years back, the government wanted to mandate CSR. So if you mandate it, then what about the taxes? It becomes part of the tax bite on people's revenue. Mm. Companies, when they set up, their first obligation is to their businesses. Mm. Second is the responsibility of tax payment. But if they don't find their way clear in voluntary taxes, what do? Mm. They don't go pay. It's between the tax man and my business. Mm-hmm. Nobody is going to pay taxes and let their business fail. Mm. And nobody's going to pay a tax consultant and then go pay taxes. So the tax law should be lowered in a way that the average Ghanaian micro, small, and medium enterprise, the educational level is below high school. So they don't understand the intricacies of tax system. Mm. Let's lower the boom. Let's lower the language. Let them understand that this is your obligation. And then let's create a staggered tax system that the 25% tax bite on everybody, once you face all, is not the way to go. Staggered taxes, tier taxes. If you make 10,000, you pay 100 cedis. If you make 20,000, you pay 200 cedis. If you make 1 million, you pay 50,000. So the 25% once you face all, should be discarded and should be reviewed. We have done a 2-year study on these taxes. We share that with internal revenue, Ghana revenue authorities. Mm. They know about it. There are other countries, Nigeria and others, are now doing this target taxes. It's not 125% for everybody. Mm. We have to go that route or we'll be left in the cold where our competitiveness will be erased.
Mm. Some will say it might be the last thing that you're looking forward to happen to you in terms of private businesses. But the Ghana city, yes, of course, has been having some challenges over the past month. Private sector worried or it was expected? Or listen, we can do better to lessen the impact of this on private businesses.
The gyration of the foreign exchange is not new. It's something that goes back and forth.
But it's
the stability of the economy that leads to that. Mm. So what do you have to do? And I started talking about we attracting foreign investments. They come in loaded with tax incentives, then we repatriate the profit home without any requirement to reinvest in the economy who generated the profit before they took it home. So what are you doing? One-way street. It goes, definitely, there's a button that we're going to hit one day.
You think that stabilize the economy and will impact on the city and rework this whole FDI arrangement where we see a lot of capital flight,
which
put pressure on the Ghana city.
Thank you. When they repatriate in profit, they don't take cedis. Mm. It goes against what? Foreign exchange. Mm. Where do they get it from? Mm. So they have to sell the cedi cheap to be able to get the volumes that they're looking for. Let's see how we balance that act.
We should check our repatriation laws.
We should check our repatriation law that if before you repatriate, if you get tax incentive, it got to be on a partnership with the local entrepreneur. So you have a partnership, some of the residual of your profit margins are left in the economy. Mm. Then before you repatriate, you can reinvest 25% in sectors unrelated to you, where you made your money. These are things that will stimulate growth.
Stagger, dividend, repatriation, and all the rest?
Yes.
Because it's putting a lot of pressure on the Ghana city.
Yes. You know, staggering dividend repatriation and profit margin is critical. If you don't, they compete among themselves. The guy said one city to $6 or six cities to $1. The guy says, I give you 10. If he doesn't give you 10, he's saddled with the city. Mm. Does he need it? No. But if you have created the opportunity for them to reinvest 5 years before they repatriate the profit margin, 25% or whatever arrangement you can come with. Because you see, most Ghanaian businesses don't get tax exemptions. Mm. Most foreign businesses that invest here get tax exemptions. Mm. Whose money is it? The taxpayer. And who is the taxpayer? The government. Mm. The government says they dangle this taxpayer money for these guys to take the profits home. They say, okay, if you want them to take the profit home, no problem with that. Mm. But let them reinvest in sectors to stimulate the growth and of those businesses, those sectors. Mm. Isn't that something that will create wealth and jobs for us instead of the one-way street that the foreign exchange generation is affecting?
That should be something that we should be doing to help.
Something we should be discussing as a policy to make sure that the Ghanaian economy is number one before the repatriation of profits home.
And that could help things out.
That could help to stabilize the economy.
Because you see,
the economy is not only city-based.
Mm.
It's multi-dimensional based. And if you allow one sector to keep going, keep going, keep going, hey, one day you're going to have a bottomless, you have, the pit, you hit the pit. Mm-hmm. And that's just about mm-hmm. it.
Mm-hmm. African free trade area, I mean, it's taking off. There are some who said that, listen, George, we're going to end up having the headquarters, but listen, others are going to eat from our bowl. 6 months or 7 months or 8 months taking off, how are we faring?
Well, it's Ghana, so fast, the CFTA, I think Ghana is way ahead of the game.
Interesting, but yes, there are a lot of businesses who don't even know about it.
You do a survey, they don't know about it.
Even to take advantage of it, Nana.
But how do you take advantage when the competitor, when you talk about the four other African countries, are not even ready for you? You want to export to whatever John Q country. They say, wait a minute, my friend, we have 10 years to open up. We haven't done that yet. But you excited because the CFTA headquarters is here, you get to know everything and all. I would want a lot more education for our private sector to understand and appreciate that. Don't jump.
So they can take advantage of it.
You can take advantage.
You think the education is low?
Very. So far as the private sector businesses are concerned. The media possibly are ahead of themselves and get to know about the CFTA. But I don't even think the Africans who are touting CFTA should be looking at competition. We should look at complementarities in the sense that don't compete among ourselves. The reason why Africa was failing and not trading among ourselves, we were doing only 20% of trade among ourselves because we all have the same raw material.
Mm.
Now we're all going to do certain things. Kenya is doing the same thing. Ghana is doing the same thing. Nigeria is doing the same thing. We're going to compete among ourselves. No, complementarities. Kenya this one, Nigeria this one, Mauritius this one.
Mm.
So at least we complement each other until we get the growth level. We have 10 years to get this liberalization done.
Mm.
But Ghana, everybody is starting that. Oh, it started a year ago and let's see how our businesses are faring.
Mm.
Go to the people in the business community and ask them about CFTA.
Do they know about it.
Do they know the competition coming?
I don't think so.
Morocco, Algeria,
South Africa,
and others have been in that competition for a long time. If they invade our territory, there goes the business.
What
levels are the businesses going to fall on? What are the alternatives?
Mm.
Do our businesses know the competition, the taste of the market that they want to invest in?
No. And in the rumor mill now, it's that tariffs could be reviewed. And definitely it might be going up. Pef, you ready for it?
Tariffs?
Yeah. Utility tariffs?
Utility tariffs?
Yeah.
Oh, please, for God's sakes, yes. We're not ready for it. This power.
The reality is that.
No. This power. Ghana is the second highest cost of power in Africa. And you're going to review for what?
But to collapse our businesses? Production challenges and other cost input challenges.
Let's put the things in the right place. Production challenges. That's why the Private Enterprise Federation and its partners, including the UNDP, are looking at renewable energy that will create affordable renewable energy off market, standalone, so that it's linked to an industrial park where the beneficiaries are the off-takers for that.
Mm.
If you replicate that around Ghana, 100.
No, in 30 seconds means you're not ready for any utility hikes. You're not ready for it?
We wouldn't even accept it.
It's PM Express Business Edition. We have to draw the curtain down, getting to understand the state of the private sector and how is this recovery hitting on them. They are not ready for any hikes in utility tariffs. I know the debate will go on in your offices and in your homes about whether private businesses are indeed picking up or not. My name is George Jaffe. This is PM Express Business Edition.
Hello, my name is Nathaniel Atta. You can catch up with all the fun and inspiration on the Joy Sports Link here on Joy 99.7 FM, together with all other shows over and over again. It's very simple. All you need to do is go to myjoyonline.com/podcast and relive all of those fun moments over and over again. Joy 99.7 FM, your radio for discerning listeners.
Hello and welcome to Springboard, a virtual university space.